Friends, my topic of deliberation today is how to optimize the fetal outcome in Rh negative pregnancies. So why we have to worry about the Rh negative pregnancies? Because in India, the incidence of Rh negative in our population is to the tune of 5%. So we all obstetricians are encountering daily Rh negative mothers in our antenatal clinic. Just to tell you the few important landmarks in the history of Rh isoimmunization, friend, the existence of Rh factor itself was discovered only in 1940. The Lilly's chart for optical density on spectrophotometry of amniotic fluid came into existence in 1963. The first direct intravascular transfusion was done by Charles in 1981. But what was the breakthrough in this field was the development of NTD immunoglobulin by William Pollack in 1968. The widespread use of NTD has led to decrease in overall incidence of immune hydrox. You can see in the year 1970, there were 82% cases of hydrox were immune hydrox, but in the year 2000, after the discovery of NTD, this incidence decreased from 82% to 10%. So this is a miracle discovery which has come into our armamentarium. I am having my presentation into three main categories: the pathogenesis, management, and prophylaxis. So in a very simple words, what happens if a mother is Rh negative and the baby is Rh positive? As you all can see, the mother is having Rh negative blood cells and the fetus is having Rh positive cells. And you can see that placenta is acting as a barrier. These positive cells are not coming into contact with the maternal cells. But sometimes this breach occurs in the placental barrier, like in cases of abortion, ectopic pregnancy, antepartum hemorrhage, when you are doing invasive fetal procedures like Corian villus sampling, amniocentesis, external cephalic version, when there is any kind of abdominal trauma at the time of delivery, when you are doing manual removal of placenta, or there is an inadvertent transfusion of Rh positive blood. So once this barrier is breached, there is an exposure of fetal antigens to the maternal circulation and the mother starts developing antibodies. And this sensitization process, that is the production of IgG antibodies against fetal RBC, it takes time. And hence it does not usually affect the first pregnancy. Antibodies remain in maternal circulation throughout the life. And once the mother is sensitized, she remains sensitized forever. There is a 1% chance of getting sensitized in antenatal period, but at the time of delivery, 10 to 15% mothers, they get sensitized. And what is the amount of blood needed for this sensitization? Friends, it is 1/4 ml. That is 0.25 ml of fetal blood is sufficient to lead to alloimmunization and cause the sensitization and can lead to indirect Coombs test positive. So what happens in future pregnancies if the mother is sensitized in the first pregnancy? The antibodies are already present in the maternal circulation, and when there is a breach, these antibodies, they cross the placental barrier, they enter the fetal circulation, and they start causing hemolysis in the fetus. And this is the dreaded complication which we all are worried, that is the hemolytic disease of fetus and newborn. During antenatal period, this hemolysis can cause fetal anemia, hydrox fetalis, and fetal death. In the neonatal period, this can lead to neonatal jaundice, Kernicterus cerebral palsy, and can also lead to neonatal death. So how to correlate this pathophysiology with our ultrasound findings? So the pathophysiology tells you that isoimmunized subsequent pregnancy, there is crossing of IgG antibodies to fetus via placenta. Antibodies, they attack the Rh positive fetal RBCs. There is fetal hemolysis and there is fetal anemia. This fetal hemolysis and fetal anemia reflects in your ultrasound findings in the form of increased cardiac output, increased cerebral arterial flow, there is extramedullary hematopoiesis, and the end result is hydrops fetalis. So you can see the ultrasound signs of fetal anemia in the form of hyperdynamic circulation, which leads to increased flow velocity. The portal vein diameter is more than 5 millimeters. Because of increased cardiac output, there is cardiomegaly. CT ratio is more than 50%. There is right atrial enlargement, tricuspid regurgitation, and pericardial effusion. Because of hyperdynamic circulation, there will be placentomegaly, which is seen as a ground glass appearance of placenta on ultrasound. Polyhydramnios will be there. And because of extramedullary hematopoiesis, you will see the hepatosplenomegaly on the ultrasound. Hydrops is the pathological accumulation of excessive fluid within two or more fetal compartments. You can see the scalp edema or body wall edema, ascites, pleural effusion, pericardial effusion, polyhydramnios, and placental thickening. So because of high output cardiac failure, this is the end stage sign of fetal anemia, and usually hydrops is visible when the fetal hemoglobin drops to less than 5 g/cl. So by preventing hydrops, we all can improve the outcome of these Rh negative pregnancies. Friends, in the field of Rh isomerization, apart from NTD, the second breakthrough which came into our clinical armamentarium is the use of middle cerebral artery peak systolic velocity as the non-invasive method to detect the fetal anemia. It was discovered by Mary et al. In 1995. And this is the most important practice-changing discovery. You can start evaluating MCA-PCV from 18 weeks onward, but it becomes less reliable after the 35 weeks of gestation. So this is a fantastic way of non-invasive monitoring of these Rh-negative pregnancies. It has a sensitivity of almost 100%, but it does have a 12% false positive rate. And MCA-PSV has safely replaced invasive testing in management of Rh isoimmunized pregnancies. MCA-PSV correlates well with the degree of fetal anemia. It identifies fetuses with moderate to severe anemia prior to hydrops, which require intrauterine transfusion. And how it identifies? Let me tell you that you have to calculate the PSV MOM. If it is more than 1.5, then this is your critical level. In clinical practice, it is very easy for you. You can just download the perinatology.com. This is the software. You just have to measure the gestational age and just measure the MCA peak systolic velocity. Enter these figures here and it automatically calculates for you the median peak systolic velocity for this age, and it tells you the multiples of median, that is MOM as well. So there is a fetal anemia if MCA-PSV is more than 1.5 MOM for that gestation. So how to proceed whenever any Rh negative mother comes to your OPD? Of course, first and foremost is taking the obstetric history in great detail, the history of previous abortions, ectopics, hydrops, fetal or neonatal death, history of blood transfusion, whether she received NTD in her prior pregnancy, and you should see that she has brought the husband's blood group and Rh report with you. Because the husband's blood group makes a lot of difference. If husband is negative, wife is also negative, practically speaking, you don't have to worry about this pregnancy. The problem starts when wife is negative and husband is positive. If wife is negative and husband is positive, we do the indirect Coombs test. Hello, please mute yourself. Support team, please mute everyone. If the indirect Coombs test is negative, the mother is non-immunized. If she is positive, she is a sensitized mother. So how you will follow up and go about the non-immunized mother? You will do indirect Coombs test at booking visit and at 28 weeks. If ICT is negative, give NTD 300 microgram at 28 weeks and repeat NTD 300 microgram post delivery within 72 hours. So this is the NTD prophylaxis. What we are giving as 300 is sufficient to cover the usual fetomaternal hemorrhage, that is the 30 ml of fetomaternal hemorrhage. A prophylactic dose of 300 microgram of NTD immunoglobulin can prevent RHD aluminization after exposure to up to 30 ml of RHD positive fetal whole blood or 15 ml of fetal RBCs. So what is the maximum dose of NTD if the fetomaternal hemorrhage is more than this amount, then what to do? In clinical situations, wherever fetomaternal hemorrhage has occurred in a volume that is not covered by our usual standard 300 microgram dose of RH immunoglobulin, you can give additional vials of RH immunoglobulin at one time. Up to 8 full vials can be administered. This should be given intramuscularly at separate sites every 12 hours once the desired dosage has been reached. An intravenous RH immunoglobulin is also available that may be used in these cases and which provides more comfort for your patient. A single dose of NTD within 72 hours of delivery reduces the rate of RHD aluminization by 80 to 90%. Some fetomaternal hemorrhage during the third trimester triggers aluminization in 2% of at-risk women before delivery, and this rate was reduced to less than 0.2% with routine NTD immunoglobulin at 28 weeks of gestation. So you have to give NTD when ICT is negative at 28 weeks, at post-delivery within 72 hours, following an episode of antepartum hemorrhage, in cases of spontaneous threatened abortion, ectopic pregnancy, if you are planning to do external cephalic version, if she comes with history of blunt trauma abdomen, and post-invasive fetal procedures. How does this prophylaxis works? The antigen on fetal RBC is not allowed to be presented to the maternal immune system. So this is how it prevents the sensitization of the mother. Overall risk of isoimmunization of RH negative mother with RH positive fetus is 16%, and this risk is reduced after NTD administration to 1%. Remember, it is not a 100% protection. And why there is a failure of 1%? It might be because you have not given antenatal prophylaxis in the third trimester, you have given insufficient dose, or you have not given it timely, or there is an unrecognized fetomaternal hemorrhage at some point in the pregnancy, which the patient has missed, which we have missed as an obstetrician. And an additional reason for RHD aluminization is the small rate of spontaneous immunization despite adherence to the recommended prophylaxis protocol. So in other words, prophylaxis is not 100% effective. At delivery, you have to take certain precautions. Don't give methargine. Try to avoid manual removal of placenta. Do early cord clamping and collect the cord blood sample for hemoglobin, direct Coombs test, blood group, and serum bilirubin. So this is what we discussed when the indirect Coombs test is negative and the mother is non-immunized. But if the test is positive and she is sensitized, then how to go about it? Then you have to see whether this is the first pregnancy or this is the subsequent pregnancy in which she gives you history of previous affected pregnancy. If this is the first RH immunized pregnancy, then the 10% of isoimmunized mothers, they have a child affected by severe hemolytic anemia. But if this is a subsequent pregnancy, then the probability of RH incompatible fetus is to the tune of 80%. And fetal anemia sets in 8 to 10 weeks earlier than in previous pregnancy. You have to do RH antibody titers, and this usually correlates well with the severity of disease. The critical titer is average is taken as 1:60. Once ICT is positive, titers are monitored every 4 weekly. If they remain below critical level, then you have to plan delivery at term. If the levels go above critical level, then you have to do follow-up as affected pregnancy. If she gives history of previous affected RH immunized pregnancy, then maternal antibodies are not predictive of severity of fetal anemia. You have to do monitoring by serial determination of MCA-PSV, should be started at 18 weeks, do every 2 to 4 weekly, and after 35 weeks, there are high chances of getting a false positive result. So if this is the first pregnancy, do serum antibody titers every 4 weekly. If the levels are less than critical, deliver baby at 38 weeks. If the values are more than critical titer level, do fetal assessment by MCA-PSV. There is no need of titers here. If she gives history of previous affected pregnancy, start serial monitoring by MCA-PSV. If the values are less than 1.5 mom, do 1 to 2 weekly monitoring by MCA-PSV Doppler. If the values are more than 1.5 mom, she needs intrauterine fetal transfusion. So to summarize, this is the first antenatal visit of an RH negative mother. You determine the RH status of the woman. If RH negative, determine the RH status of the husband. If she is negative with RH positive husband, perform ICT titer. There are three possibilities. ICT titer is either negative, is less than 1:16, that is the critical level, or is more than 1:16, which is the critical level. If the ICT titers are negative, repeat titer every 4 weeks, give NTD at 28 to 32 weeks, and repeat NTD within 72 hours of birth. If the values are less than 1:16, repeat titer every 2 weeks, deliver at normal time, no NTD prophylaxis is needed. If ICT titer is more than 1:16, every 2 weeks you have to do the MCA-PSV and look for the features of high drops. If the MCA-PSV is 1.5 mom or more, you have to repeat after 1 week. If it remains at that level, you have to perform the cardiocentesis and intrauterine transfusion. If the features of high drops are present, please refer them to a fetal medicine specialist for intrauterine fetal transfusion, and you can plan delivery at 35 weeks or later. When to deliver these infants is a controversial subject. Standard treatment is to prolong the pregnancy until the fetus reaches a gestational age which is necessary for survival. If the history and antenatal studies indicate only mild fetal hemolysis, it is reasonable to proceed with delivery by induction at 37 to 38 weeks. But if she has received intrauterine transfusion, you can decide as per the case after 34 weeks. Important to remember is that you have to document the NTD. If you are given NTD, paste a counterfoil in the patient notes. Tell her and her husband to remember that she has received the NTD, so that if for her subsequent pregnancy she goes to some other doctor, some other place, they will be able to give the history of receiving NTD injection. Always give NTD injection intramuscularly in deltoid region and not in the buttock region. Before giving NTD, check for the storage, the validity dates, the expiry dates, everything. Blood group and RH factor must be checked for every antenatal patient in the first visit itself. If she is RH negative, then indirect Coombs test should be done at the first visit and should be repeated at 28 weeks of gestation. Any sensitizing event in a rhesus negative pregnancy must alert the obstetrician towards the possibility of fetomaternal hemorrhage. Adequate NTD prophylaxis can prevent isoimmunization, and if still she is isoimmunized, you have to follow with fetal MCA Dopplers at centers where intrauterine transfusion facilities are available. Friends, remember the fetal medicine here is in the star, because this is a teamwork, the management of RH negative pregnancy. It requires neonatologists, obstetricians, hematologists to have the optimum fetal outcome in these RH negative patients. So thank you so much for your patient hearing. If there are any questions, I am happy to answer.